have any questions, please do ask. The best time to ask the question is when you have the question, so please do stop us and ask the question when you have it. So, right, so this conference was coming up and we both felt that we should, you know, do a presentation here or at least a workshop, which is why, you know, being the agile experts that we are, we said let's start off with actually, you know, building a backlog, which is what most agile guys do.
Yeah, so you can read the story. The first one I'll explain and then onwards we'll just run through this. The first story we said is that if you have to present at this conference, as agile presenters, we are the experts here. We want to create a backlog so that we can actually get it done, right? And we have five NUTs, which is basically our way of effort estimation, which is called nebulous units of time. So we have five nebulous units of time. And on that side, you actually see 100 BV, which means 100 business value. So 100 is a hypothetical number, which is relative number that we try to say this. If we complete this story, we can achieve 100 business value. Right? So that was the first story we wrote, which was about creating our backlog. Now let's have a look at actually what our backlog was. So this is about a list of stories that we try to put in our backlog.
So, the first story there was the fact that we needed a title for the talk. We had to submit, you know, our proposal. So we said, let's, you know, as a presenter, we actually need a title. That will actually attract you guys here. And hopefully, that sort of did what it had to. Then, again, that's one nut. We thought it's a simple task for us to do. And the business value was 500 for that.
So that was our first story. Our next story was about actually, you know, we have a title now. What do we do with the title? If I have to propose a topic, then I also need an abstract so that the conference program committee will actually look at the abstract and select the topic. So we said the next story we actually have to complete is to actually, as presenters, come up with an abstract that is interesting for people and is in line with the conference theme. Right? So we came up with an abstract for this. I mean, this is just, we're talking about the backlog that we created. The next story we had,
right, so once it would get accepted, you know, we would have to start building an outline, we would have actually have to start breaking down our tasks and start working on them. So we said, you know, as presenters, we'll actually need an outline so that we can start working on the content for the workshop.
Anyone familiar with as AI want to show that format of story writing? Yeah, so we are the experts and we actually make sure we follow the template, we don't miss any of that stuff. Things.
Right, so you know, we're really fed up of the accusations by all the non-believers, the agile non-believers, that they said the agile community is not user-centric. So we said, you know, we need to give a lot of a high priority to usability, which is why one of our stories is actually about usability. We said that we need our slides to be usable, so it's clear for the conference attendees, and you know, the message is conveyed to them very clearly.
Yeah, we care a lot about our users. Customer delight, you know, this is kind of what I guess you guys come to the conference to get delighted. You wanna learn something new, you wanna go back satisfied saying, you know, we actually learned something new at this conference. So we said that's a fairly important story for us. So if you see 2,500 business value, and it's fairly complex task to actually satisfy the people who come to attend the talk, right? So this is a fairly complex task and it's estimated at a 35 nuts.
And obviously the most obvious of the stories is that we need the content for the workshop so we can actually conduct and do what we're doing right now. It's also pretty complicated to work 30 nuts because it's a lot of work to come up with all the content and fairly high business value again, 2100 there.
I mean, we're of course the agile experts out here and we know that, you know, sometimes people get stuck in just writing a lot of stories and not doing anything. So we said enough of, you know, writing stories. We have a fair what we want to do and we can actually get started. We can start our planning and we can, you know, start working on the things so we can actually start delivering something and not get caught up in the whole analysis paralysis mode.
Yeah, this is where we experts get our Zen-like agile intuition and we know that we have to start working on this.
So that's enough about stories and backlog. Let's talk about adaptive planning. How did we go about planning our session? Right? So we are strong believers in Scrum. And we started off with sprint planning, and I guess most of you would have heard of sprint 0 or sprint 1. So we started with sprint 1, and that's kind of how we started planning the first sprint. Sandeep and I have delivered similar talks at previous conferences, so we had some sense of what our velocity is, which kind of roughly boiled down to about 12 knots was our velocity. We had about 5 hours before we realized that tomorrow morning is the deadline for submission of the workshops. So we kind of sat one evening for 5 hours, which was what our capacity was. And we planned, we picked up two stories. The goal of this sprint was to actually put in a proposal. Right? So we played the freezing on the title story, and we played the workshop abstract story.
So keep in mind that we're not doing this full time. We obviously have jobs, so you know, which is why pay attention to the capacity, because you know we're talking about the number of hours that we can give to this as well.
Yep, really important. So that's our first sprint plan, roughly. And this is our burn down when we started. We totaled whatever we had collected, about 900 odd story points we had. So that's where we got. Sorry?
Not 94.
94. Sorry. I keep getting confused. So we had about 94 story points, and that's where our burn down, that's how our burn down chart looked when we started off.
It's just a side note, me and Arish actually pair on a lot of things, and that was one example of the advantage of pairing. You could see, you know, each one can help the other out when they're making a mistake as well.
Yeah, we love pairing.
Yeah.
So the first story, right? It was quite exciting because we wanted to come up with a title for the workshop. So we talked about what should be the title. We brainstormed a few ideas about what we want to talk about.
Right. Some of the stuff that we discussed were in terms of, you know, let's keep it a little vague so that, you know, we can find, when we get the time to work on the actual content, we could sort of play around with it. We have that space around which we can do that. So we wanted to keep it a little vague, but at the same time, we wanted it to be interesting as well.
Yeah, the whole lean software movement, if you guys have heard about the lean philosophy where they talk about last responsible moment, they kind of embrace that full time, you know. It's like last responsible moment. Let's push things as far as we can. Which is funny because we'll talk about that later how far. But let's see what this actually.
Notice how we didn't use the word procrastination there.
So the first title we came up was Fuck That Shit was the title of our topic. It was kind of fairly abstract, and we said, you know, this is kind of what's running through our mind in what is happening in the Agile community. So this is what we want to talk about.
This is also inspired by a comic strip by a very famous. Artist called, whose comic is called XKCD. Anyone heard of it?
Any XKCD fans? Yeah. Right. So this is basically picked up from there in terms of the title. We said this kind of resonates with what we want to speak, and that's where the title. And it was fairly easy. We got the story done. I mean, it was one that took some time, but once we got the title, we were rolling with it. Let's move on. Next story we had was about writing workshop abstract.
Here again, we didn't want to spend a lot of time doing this. However, we wanted it to be interesting, like we said. It had to be along the themes of the theme of the conference as well, so that we get selected. And again, we used the fact that we were inspired by the XKCD comics, so we sort of borrowed some of the text from there, and we came up with our abstract.
So in case you've not seen our abstract, this was our abstract. I'll give you a millisecond to read this. Don't try and read the comic because that's too long.
Yeah, but that's the fun part. You want to read it later on the website if you haven't already.
The gist is that basically we don't have all the answers. We don't know what's the best way, what's the right way to do stuff. But certainly over the years we've had experience about what is not working and what we believe does not actually make sense. So instead of just blindly following, mindlessly following the experts because and doing the practices that they say, we wanted to do something different. So that's the abstract that we came up with. And that was easy. We submitted it. The conference committee really liked it. They selected it. And our first sprint was done.
So that breakdown chart is the perfect picture of a sprint gone well.
Yeah, dude. We need a high five for that. That was awesome.
That's an example of how you do it right.
We selected two stories, we burned it 5 hours, we got everything done, and it was absolutely smooth. Right, so that was our rundown of the first sprint.
Yeah.
Then we, once the program was announced, we collected customer feedback. Right? Everyone does that.
You put something out there. You want customer feedback. So as soon as the program was announced, whether you want it or not, the customers do give you feedback once it's out there, and the feedback started rolling in for us. This slide is a reference to a mail in the mailing list. How many of you all are there on the mailing list and following it?
On the Agile mailing list, yeah.
Someone referred to our talk as the elephant in the room and asked the others if anyone's seen it. So that's what this is a reference to.
So yeah, there were also some really good feedback about people saying that, you know, your title is very offensive. We can't send it around in our company. People will get offended and things like that. So we recognized that. We appreciated the feedback. And we basically said, all right, time to write a new story.
That's what we allow guys to write a story. So
it's all about stories, man. So we came up with a new story, which was change offensive title. And we wanted to change the offensive title so that we don't offend our prospective conference attendees, right? So we are
the paying customers, that's you guys.
Yeah. We spent quite a bit, but when we introduced this story, you will notice that our burn down chart actually had a little bump up there. We went up from 82 points to back up to 85 points. So now we have to burn down the extra 3 points, which is 85 points. Now we started planning a second sprint, which is, this time we had a little more time, and we had like about 10 hours the capacity that we could spend. And we took on 20 story points after the successful completion of the first sprint. We were pretty confident that we will complete these three stories. Change offensive title, slide usability, we wanted to get usability in up front, else it would be too late. And then basically get a workshop outline so we can start parallelizing work and start working on it. So far, you guys with us? Yeah? Yes?
Sorry, you mentioned 3 points. One is the business value, nuts, and story points.
So nuts is story points.
Okay.
It's a way of doing.
Nuts is a way of. So nuts is like more of a generic term that people use, nebulous units of time. Story points is one of them. Ideal developer days is another one. So there are all these different notations.
T-shirt sizes
in some sense, yeah.
Business value,
how did you arrive at that? Like, is it, as you were saying, it's relative,
so we have.
So we look at some stories, we say, you know, this seems like really high business value, so let's put it on one extreme. Let's say 2,500 story point. This is fairly low business value, so let's say this is 100 business value. And then where does this stand? So we relatively basically.
It's relative to the stories themselves, it's not objective in that sense. So when you're looking at 2006 in relation to the other story.
It's an absolute figure.
It's not an absolute figure, it's a relative figure.
So it's more or less the time estimation we do. Like
it's similar to the story point estimate for business value.
Yeah.
Right?
So the time estimate tells you how long it's going to take itself, but the business value is telling you whether you want to do that first or not. Or
but both
when
the things are relative.
Both are relative, yes.
Yeah.
That's right.
It's not very particular about this. I missed the beginning of the conversation. What is so offensive about the title?
What is so offensive about the title? We'll take it offline.
Okay.
It's the four letter F word that.
Okay. I thought monkey see monkey do.
No. Before monkey see monkey do, we actually had a different
that
title.
Welcome, but
even the last four letter word was not very pleasant.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, so
thank you.
So people don't like four-letter words. We realized that we adapted, we inspected and adapted, and we evolved from there. Right? That's what we agile experts do, inspect and adapt. So let's talk about the first story. How did we go about actually building the first story? We said, you know, we came up with the title. People didn't like it. The chances are us coming up with another title that people will like is relatively less. So let's crowdsource, right? Everyone's familiar with crowdsourcing. So we basically asked on the mailing list, what do you guys think the title of this talk should be? And we got some really wonderful suggestions. I asked on Twitter, I got a lot of feedback on Twitter. Some people on the mailing list replied back to us. We got some really good suggestions, and we picked up one winner. I mean, actually before that, I really liked this one. This was almost our second Janta Ki Adalat Mein Aaj Agile Practices. was a pretty neat title for this. But we finally settled for Monkey See, Monkey Do because it kind of, it still kept it quite abstract.
Let's go back.
Yeah.
So even this was suggested or?
The Monkey See, Monkey Do was also suggested roughly in some sense, but we kind of, you know, it's like you take customer feedback and then you figure out, you do analysis and then you figure out what would be the best for them. So we came up with this
thing. A lot of times customers will tell you what they want, not what they need. So, you know, we got an idea that this is, you know, sort of what they wanted. So then we came up with this idea and it made sense for us.
So, bingo! We got the story point for this one. We completed this story. That's fairly simple. We asked people, we got feedback, we picked up story, we did some study, and we came up with the title. So we changed that title, and that's a story completed. It's done. Now you guys even know the title. The next one we wanted to work was on slide usability. We wanted our slides to be extremely usable. We wanted to make sure that people can get the gist of it. So,
here again, you know, we did the same. We asked the people what they think should be, how the slide should look, and we got some suggestions from people. We got a couple of links from them, so we had to research these as well.
We got some good links, we researched about them, we did some analysis, and basically we came up with
this template for our slides, which is what you've been seeing so far, right? This was the template that we came up with.
Oh man, looks like there were some typos there.
Sorry about that.
I have fixed that.
I've just checked in. It's gonna run the build. Do you wanna go to waitingforbuild.com and just check out?
How many guys have been to waiting for the build?
Alright.
Few people.
The guys who haven't, you guys should check it out.
Pretty cool thing when you check in code and you're waiting for the build to finish. This is the place you should go, waitingforthebuild.com. Alright, I think the build is green. I can see it going fine.
There you go.
Hey!
Alright.
Continuous integration thing is amazing. You just make mistakes, check in and stuff just comes out on the other end. Pretty neat. So there we get. We got the usability, we asked people, we sent them, we on the mailing list we even sent out a slide and we asked people how did they feel about the slide. People gave us some feedback, we did some research and we figured out that for video recording and stuff like that, black background, a dark background is better and things like that. So based on all of that we did and we came up with this.
So far so good.
Let's talk about this. Right. Workshop outline, which kind of was quite critical for us to actually have an outline for the workshop. We started working on this.
But as you can see, we didn't get anything done here, right? We did our story point estimates, we did our stories, we did our planning based on them, you know, we knew our velocity, but yet we didn't finish, right? This is what we had. Why do you think we didn't finish this part, this story?
What went wrong in this script? Why couldn't we finish this? Everything seemed to be going fine.
Any guesses?
Just had some other work to do.
Maybe something came up. There's nothing to add. We didn't have any outline.
Yeah.
We actually had lots of ideas for outline.
Like writer's block. Right, that's what we were supposed to do. We were supposed to sit and think about it. But
supposed to come up with an outline. That was the point of this story. So what happened was this dude went out drinking one night and just fell sick.
Yeah.
And
I'm known for that, having a weak immune system, so I keep falling sick.
So we couldn't complete the story and the story went into a hangover, which means we're gonna play the story the next iteration. This happens, I mean this is what all Agile is about, inspect and adapt, adaptive planning. We plan for some stuff and it doesn't finish, so that's okay. We move into the next sprint and we work on it in the next sprint.
Okay, perfect. So obviously when you look at your business value, right, this is the most important.
Right.
What's the use of having a title without the content?
The point working on the outline when you don't have a title?
No, right? Just to clarify, the title was necessary because we had to submit it to the contract.
There are some constraints in the business
constraints.
It's
automatically
right?
Important from that sense.
Okay.
For the product owner, business value is low. But for it to get accepted,
that drove, you know, like you have some kind of dependencies. We had a dependency on this story which we had to play it with.
In the same sense, changing the title, we could have done that later as well, but we had to, you know, change it right away so it appears on the program. So therefore it was automatically imported.
We were constantly taking feedback, adapting to what our customers need, and you know, we were working that out. So this is our burn down after the next sprint. We kind of had 77 points. We were hoping to burn a lot more down, but because this guy fell sick, we couldn't do that. Let's talk about the sprint 3. Sprint 3, we wanted to work on same the workshop outline and the most important story, which was the customer delight story.
Yeah, this time we know that, you know, we don't have much time. So we decided to give it more time as well. We were putting in 20 hours there.
Customer delight. What is the customer delight story? The idea was that, you know, our product owner said we want to make sure that the users learn stuff from this workshop and they feel delighted at the end of it. So obviously, you know, this was still vague for us. We couldn't understand what this actually means. So we looked at what could be the acceptance criteria for this story. What does it mean to actually complete this story? How do we know we're actually done with this story? How will we know we've actually delighted the customer?
So that's a question that we came up with, the answer for which we had to find so that we could complete the story, right? What is it that we need to do that will delight the customer? And how will we know when we do that?
So we actually looked up about a lot of conferences, close to about 1,000 conferences. We looked at the talks that speakers do. We try to analyze what is going on, and we try to understand when customers are delighted. And one of the things we kind of found out was that, you know, how do we measure, you know, if customers are delighted? We know that some talks customers are delighted, some talks customers are not delighted. When I mean customers, we mean audience. So how do we distinguish? We need some kind of a metrics to actually calculate that. By closely watching the thing, what we realized was towards the end of the talk is when, you know, you can actually sense if people were satisfied or not. You know, at the beginning, it's too early to say whether the customers are delighted or not. So
I think all through you can judge that.
All through? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. I mean,
until the end.
So we will see that, right? So based on our study, we figured out that it's typically towards the end, and one of the metrics we found which was quite helpful is we noticed that the intensity with which people clap kind of shows how happy they are, right? So one of the things we saw is if we started measuring that metrics, the key thing was people clap when they see the thank you slide. Right? When people see the thank you slide, they clap a lot.
Thank God it's over.
So we found a high correlation between, you know, people clapping and thank you slide.
And that's why we thought, you know, thank you slide is most important. So we'll start with the thank you slide. That was not too good.
Obviously.
Anyway, so that story is done. We started again working on the workshop outline. Right? And what happened this time? We of course follow Pomodoro. You guys have heard Dave talk about Pomodoro. So we followed Pomodoro technique. And
we ran out of time, right? All that research that we did on what would make our customers happy and how to figure that out sort of took up all our sprint time.
Yeah.
So we ran out of time and we didn't get around to doing that.
We ended up with only burning 42 story points down. This is where we stand. Right, so here is where our presentation stands. This is all we could get done.
This is it, guys.
We got a pretty kindful sponsor.
Sorry?
We got a pretty kindful sponsor.
Not a pretty kindful sponsor. Our audience are not happy.
One more thank you.
Let's go back to the thank you.
Thank you, Slack. We have some deliverables. So that brings us to the real title of this talk.
Right, this is a title that you guys haven't seen. This is the actual title of the talk that we didn't publish. Right? Now it's not what you think, right?
We already burned our hands once.
What do you think?
So we didn't want to go down this path.
Yeah. Who here thinks knows what WTF is?
Wonderful.
Right. Yeah, we already burned our hands doing that. We are smart individuals, we are expert agile practitioners, we don't repeat mistakes.
Yeah, we did that retrospective and we don't repeat the mistakes.
Why you got the fun?
Alright, let's cut the chase. Agile way to fail. This was a demonstration so far of what you saw. There is we tried to monkey see, monkey do. You know, stories and this and that and all the things that we don't actually really even understand, and we try to follow them. And
we did everything by the book, right? But we still fail.
Our goal was that, you know, our thinking was that if we could do what the experts are saying and we could mimic that, then we will be extremely successful. Right? But we ended up with this. So now we want to cut the chase and really get to our talk.
The highlight of that was that, you know, Agile is not a silver bullet, right? Nothing can be. There are no silver bullets out there.
Let's take an example. Anyone familiar with this company? Yeah?
Anyone not familiar with this company?
Good.
Then you can stand on the naughty bench over there in the corner. So what do you think is the top reason behind Toyota's success? What is the top reason behind Toyota's success? Why is Toyota so successful? People consider Toyota as a successful company? Yes, extremely successful in the car manufacturing industry. What do you think is the single most important reason for Toyota's success?
Continuous innovation.
Continuous innovation.
Building what the customer wants.
Building what the customer wants. Do you mean the other guys are not doing that?
Yeah, kind of.
Maintaining quality.
Get rid of the waste.
Get rid of waste.
Lean management.
Like they thought of what they are actually in and devise a solution for the
needs. Devise a solution for the needs. So,
we all seem to have a fair idea of why they are successful, right? There are books about this that tell you, you know, how they did it. And how they succeeded. But
why is there only one Toyota? We seem to know all the answers, right? Toyota did this, Toyota did that, Toyota was successful for this, Toyota was successful
for that. They wanted to be always
successful. They wanted to be always successful. All of us want to be successful.
Perseverance. Because they did what they wanted. They didn't copy it from anyone else. Because everyone started aping Toyota. They didn't figure out what would work for them. They started thinking like what worked for Toyota.
That brings us back, I guess, why you folks came up with this workshop. You try to follow the form for getting the essence.
Yeah.
When you follow the form and you don't understand the essence behind the form, you're left with the facade.
And even let's say we are no kiddos out here, right? We understand the essence.
Yeah, you are agile experts, exactly.
We are the agile experts, right? So,
you understand every aspect of the form.
We understand every single practice, every single thing under the belt, you know? We are like,
yeah, I'm a certified Scrum wizard as well.
Oh, what's that, dude?
I have
no idea. Certified Scrum wizard. Did you get that patented already?
Yeah, I paid some $50 for it.
So we want to actually do an individual activity. What we want you to do is take the next 2 minutes and think about what are the indispensable practices on your team that today you practice them, right? Whether you do Agile, whether you do something else, it doesn't matter. Whatever you're doing today on your team, what are the indispensable practices do you guys think on your team? So take 2 minutes and just chalk down those points in terms of what are the indispensable practices, right? Individually. Okay. That's 2 minutes. Next, what we want you to do is self-organize, form some groups of 3, 4, 5 people, self-organize, form some groups. And what we want you to think about in the groups, have a discussion. You have 5 minutes, you can form teams of 5 people, up to 5 people. What practices do you think are indispensable for every project that you think of, right? So you've thought about for your current project what practices are indispensable. Now form groups, have discussion about what do you think for every project is indispensable, things that you can't throw away from projects. So form self-organized, form groups of 4 or 5 people and have these discussions. All right guys, it's 5.5 minutes. So let's go around. you guys can talk about what are the practices that you came up with. We don't want detailed explanation, we just want the list of practices that you guys thought are indispensable for every project. Alright? So we'll start here.
Just one person from a group can stand up or whatever.
You don't need to stand up,
you can just be seated and read it out.
Okay, anyhow, that's not a problem. Setting a goal or a vision, defining the requirement.
So, that's the only one which is common to everyone.
That's okay.
Then communication, then testing and quality, tracking and reviewing, then team management, somebody has come up with. Customer focus, and then innovate and adaptability, planning and scheduling, continual improvement and learning. That's all.
Alright, that's a good list of things. Let's go there and see what you guys have come up with. Just read it out loud.
Okay, one is, I'll probably read it out in the order in which, you know, most people had a consensus for that. So one would be, you know, coding and code quality and working on the software. Basically doing the stuff, getting things done. In the sense that not just ideating all the time, writing code even if it's horrible and, you know, probably improving that later on. And all, obviously making sure that it's of a certain decent amount of quality. Second would be, I mean, you can call it pair programming, you can call it communication or talking to your group and, you know, making sure everyone knows what's happening and stuff like that. So that's probably also related to a daily and weekly stand-up somehow, because that means that everyone is, you know, in the loop and guys know what's happening, and it doesn't land up in a situation where someone is on different wavelength and stuff like that. Then another thing is getting feedback from your clients or customers or users, whoever they may be. If it's an API, it could be your internal app. If it's a client-facing thing, it could be, you know, whatever. Another thing which it may go against Agile, but at least some of us strongly think is that you should be clear about your requirements and not change them unless it's extremely required to change them. So even if you think that, you know, it's slightly, probably yesterday you thought A and today you think A dash, probably still go ahead with A and not just change A dash, because it changes a lot of things as far as programmer is concerned, and it just causes havoc and, you know, there's motivational issues also. And another thing is focusing on the title or on the problem statement. So you tend to, you know, digress and go along tangential routes, probably, you know, try to explore some academically interesting problems that you may want to solve and lose focus of what you actually do want to do, which may be very trivial, but, you know, because it's so trivial, you don't want to do it, probably. And another thing is avoiding recurring mistakes. If you already had, you know, if you already did some mistake or you already encountered some situation and solved it in a certain way, just remember that's how you did it and, you know, try not to go down that route. And code reviews. So probably that is again somehow related to, you know, talking to your group and pair programming. It's kind of like one stops and the other starts. And design before code. Which again some people may disagree with, you know, like upfront design. But sometimes it's like very useful because you know what you want, and, you know, if you already know what you want, you can probably do it much faster and much better. It's like an already solved problem and, you know, you're just picking that up and applying the same thing.
Alright, that's a good list. Group here.
Right. The things we came across was start off in the order which we thought the process goes on.
Yeah, cut the chase, tell the points.
So, planning would be one. Sizing and staffing issues, the number of resources. Articulating what is the done criteria, as to in the number of steps, breaking it down, what is exactly when it gets done, things like that. Then would be engineering practices like TDD, refactoring, stuff like that. Metrics would be another one, which we thought would capture things like continuous integration or burn down charts or velocity, things like that. And reviews and retrospection coupled with stand-up meetings. And also another factor we thought, I don't know if it is relevant or not, but there's a learning curve also involved. So that is some sort of a point that we could always incorporate. And obviously maintenance. These are some of the things that we thought.
Okay. Some are practices, some are more higher level things. But that's okay. Let's come here.
There are three things which we thought. One is planning for the iterations.
sprints and continuous integration, and then having customer feedback and then incorporating that. Best effort was of it.
Plus three practices.
We are not saying anything. I'm just asking what the groups are coming up with, and then we'll have a discussion about, because things are at different levels. You know, when we talk about practices, we're talking about communication. Is communication a practice or it's a value? So there are all these different levels that we want to talk through that.
So we came out with pre-planning as one, coding and PDD, then see and tell with the different feedback as often. Huddle for positive confrontation to talk about stuff they're doing. Then CI and work for each other as a team.
Okay, so team. So as you guys noticed, you know, each team came up with kind of discrete set of, you know, some had overlap, but some had, you know, these different practices that they thought were, you know, indispensable for every team. Why do you think there's so much variation in terms of what everyone came up with?
Before you answer that,
yeah,
the fact that the word every is there strike you? What you're thinking from that sense that, you know, these practices apply to every project?
So we, like when we announced, right, we had only one practice which was common to all what we thought initially, which was having a project vision. Apart from that, everyone else thought a different set was actually indispensable for them. But we just grouped it all kind of together.
Right,
so,
right. Go ahead.
There's no cookbook. It's first thing.
There's no cookbook.
And everything is unique, everything is distinct. So that is where, that's the whole magic of it.
Probably that's how you come up with a set of best practices.
Now, what I'm wondering is, we talked about lots of different things which are kind of, in some cases, some people said, you know, this might be against Agile, but this is a good practice, and somebody else said, you know, somebody else talked about practices that were all, you know, specifically Agile practices that you would need. So what I'm trying to understand is, why is there so much variation? You know, there is no cookbook, different situations are different. So can we come up with best practices that apply across all projects was kind of where I was going to.
No.
How many people think you can come up with a set of practices that apply across all projects? And how many people think, the rest of you think, there is nothing that applies across all projects?
Few of the practices which, are, no, which can be
I would say that again, that would depend upon the term you use, that levels. Probably if you look at a higher level, then probably we can come up with best practices. But when you go to a more granular level, then it would be a little difficult to implement.
So what you're getting at is, we talked about practices, we talked about values, we talked about something bigger than that, which is kind of more of a cultural thing.
Yes.
And we had all these different levels. And at practices level, there could be a lot of variation.
Yes,
at values level, maybe there's less variation and more agreement in terms of, you know, these are communication, feedback, and things like that are all values that we all value and we want to embrace them.
Yes.
So that's kind of what you're thinking is. That's pretty good, because what we wanted to talk about next was, you know, the bloat effect. Have you guys experienced the bloat effect? You start on a team, and you start with a set of practices, but as you go along, the number of practices that you use on the team starts increasing, the number of people on the team starts increasing, the number of bugs starts increasing, the number of the amount of time it takes to produce something starts increasing. So there's a bloat effect that kind of happens. And how many people try to throw away practices? Yeah, that's great to know.
With respect to the question that, or the thing that you mentioned, that, you know, maybe at the values level we can have some sort of an agreement, but not at the practice level. How many of you all have been in a situation where, you know, you're actually you're doing a practice, but no one remembers what the value was, why you're doing it now?
Yeah. What's the rationale behind some practices? So we want to talk about a few practices which we're going to talk about next, and want to talk about what is the rationale behind it, what's the value behind it, and why we think it's completely useless to do that in specific contexts. Of course, we're not making generic statement that this is true for every project, but we're trying to take a stand that from our view of the world today, the way we are operating, these things just seem like too much of a process, too much of a ritual. And we want to talk through some of that without taking an extreme stand, but trying to bring a new perspective to the table.
Yeah. Please keep in mind that we are playing the devil's advocate here. We will make maybe extreme statements, but that's only so that you guys think about some of the stuff that you guys are doing. And you don't end up in the place where you're, you know, doing the practices without knowing what the values are.
It's like dancing around the fire, thinking, you know, something will happen. Does anyone know about that story where there was this group in a native group in America which used to generally dance around the fire thinking food will drop from the top? And they did that during the Second World War, and because there was all these flights flying out, they would drop food when they would see smoke coming up. And once the war was over, there was no food, and people would still keep dancing around the fire thinking that food will drop from the top. You know, it kind of becomes like that. A lot of times you go visit teams and you see they're doing some rituals and some practices, but nobody knows why and how, what difference would it make. What do you guys think is the rationale or the advantages of doing release planning and sprint planning?
Here we also want to be interactive, so you know, you guys can come up with your thoughts on this.
This is more of a discussion. We want to go into more of a discussion mode. We want to take feedback from people. We want to share our perspectives, and we want to go into this chaotic discussion mode.
Yeah, like we said, you know, we don't have all the answers, so we are here to discover them as well with you guys.
See, release planning will help us, you know, in sizing and prioritizing. And sprint planning will get me into the engineering task involved.
Right, break it down into the task that we need to do.
I'll come there in a minute.
Forecasting.
Identifying dependencies. Dependencies in what sense? With other teams?
Could be with what needs to get done first before we
module dependencies.
What else? Anything else?
To some extent, it will ease the senior management decision making.
Ease the senior management decision process.
So, I want you guys to think about this, right? We are not seeing a lot of hands raised. You guys are doing this. Can you think about why you're doing it and what value you're getting out of it also?
Yeah, I personally think that, although I know on the ground that it will not add much value to it, but I do have to pay lip service to somebody because we work in the client and vendor scenario all the time. So they ask us for this upfront, and if I don't do it, there will be more fire that I cannot even start the project. So as opposed to saying all those things, we accept those things, okay, this is a shit, but then we do something. At least it will give some inclination where it is going, and they will be silenced, and the team also gets, okay, this is what the target is, let's try to work towards that. But we all know that it will dwindle, and we have to regroup again to do something.
Right, so you guys are just doing it for the sake of doing it then?
No, well, see,
it's required for the client.
No, but see, I come from the IT services background, right. So most of our customers who come and say that, you know, we want to go agile because of certain reasons, and they have interested us. We are a traditional organization, and we are not in a mode where we say we advocate agile as incomplete because we have to safeguard our rights. That's where the thing is. So now, but we are also taking on projects we have to do. Now, in this model, do you want to follow the agile philosophy in all this sense and try to produce results where it is purely a bottom-up to the top approach, where the traditional people come from the top to the bottom approach, and then you get caught in all this? So do you want to get caught in the crossfire, or try to take this philosophy, okay, this is there and they have been advocating, it helps, so long as it can help. So as a mentor or a coach, you want to put that in perspective, but then not get too much, led into it, but, you know, let it be at the surface. If the team wants to go there, you correct them and pull them back.
That's a good point. That I sense is more pragmatic about this is what is required. Let's not get caught up in this. Let's do just enough so that we can move ahead and start working on stuff. That's a good perspective. You have.
I believe it is also a good platform to have the entire team on the same page for what is to be done and how it is to be done.
So more of a communication and visioning exercise for the team. Setting the focus for the entire team. So all those are good points.
Between release planning and sprint planning. So sprint planning is like totally useless for us. We don't do it at all. But release planning is kind of useful to understand, okay, we have all these things to do. Which one do we want to do first? Which one do we want to do later? And what is important, what is not important? and then figuring out, okay, we can do these as our first release, we can do these as our second release.
So we're going to talk about some of the things we have noticed that happens. You know, we talk a lot about, you know, this whole sense of adaptive planning, right? Iteration planning and sprint planning and release planning is all about adaptive planning, right? How much of adaptiveness is actually there when you start, you know, signing up for a release plan and you say, okay, we're going to work on this release plan and you start working on this. How much adaptiveness is there in real sense? Is something we've experienced that people get too tied with the plan. You know, is the notion of delivering to a plan instead of planning to deliver kind of a behavior. And even at this agile scale that people do, we feel that still, you know, that sense of getting too tied up, getting too attached with your plan, or you know, just following the plan because you have put a plan together, you've spent so much effort trying to come up with it, kind of starts continuing happening. So that's one of the big things that I have noticed.
There's also something that maybe I didn't mention directly, but you know, we as humans can't deal with uncertainty. So for a lot of people, the release planning and the sprint planning sort of gives them certainty to some sense, right? A sense of certainty at least. And what we notice is that when you do that, when you know disparate teams have the sense of certainty, they then go back to their silos again and they're working and they come back after the release, right? So you actually end up building walls sometimes in between these because they think they have certainty in terms of where they are going, right? That sort of breakdowns the communication between the teams as well, is what we've noticed.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually a very strong point. We can talk about that a lot. If you take your personal experience and, you know, do a retrospective on that, you will see that there is this false sense of security that comes in, or false sense of certainty that creeps in when you think, oh, we have a plan, we've thought through it, this is exactly where we're going. Velocity is showing us that we're on track. And you know, sometimes that doesn't really match with what it is, but it's kind of creating this false sense of security.
Would you say there's a problem with following the plan rather than creating the plan and making it adaptable?
So again, that's the point we are getting at, is planning is important, but plans are useless, right? The act of planning, thinking through and constantly trying to keep planning and really being adaptive about it is more important than the act of having a plan and following the plan.
But sometimes also the fact that you're planning and you're creating that plan, I mean, we're obviously talking about this very macro level, right? When you're doing that, you end up, you know, delivering to the plan also. So the fact that you did it means that you might end up doing this.
You get attached to it in some sense. I mean, Scrum has this practice of, you know, basically terminating a sprint when things change. And how many people do often terminate their sprints? If you look around, there are very few people who will actually terminate the sprint because they've already spent a lot of time planning. Now, you don't want to terminate the sprint and go through the whole process again. So, you know, things like that is an example of, you know, you're getting attached to your plans. You're getting attached to delivering to that spec. It was interesting, Drew mentioned about, you know, even if the requirement changes, you want to still deliver because that has implications on, you know, on the coding aspects and the development aspects, so you want to stick with that. And you know, we're not saying that's wrong. We're saying that's something to think about in perspective, that sometimes that's a valid thing to do, sometimes it is not. If we try to build this silver bullet answers that this is the exact way of doing everything, we try to apply it everywhere, and you know, it doesn't work that way.
But we need to move on. Yeah, one final point is that you also notice there's a lot of overhead that you put into the process when you do something like this, which in a lot of cases ends up being wasted effort also.
How much time do typically people spend on their release plans? Rough numbers. 1 day, 5 days, 1 week, 15
six
minutes,
months.
Six half. Months.
Half an hour.
Half an hour?
1 day.
1 day.
1 day. On release plans. What about sprint plans?
0 minutes.
0 minutes.
Way to go.
Again, think about these things is our point, right? How much time you're spending, how much value is it adding?
One question here is, say, if you take a complete organization where there are like too many people working, and if you want to, you know, make people, not delivering exactly, at least have some collaboration to be working between them, then you need to have a plan, right? I mean, or at least at the organization level, like when you are building a product, like, say for example, thousands of people work in it, and there will be like hundreds of teams. So how do you get them on the same platform so that everyone kind of merges it once?
So two things. We are not saying don't have plants, right?
Yeah.
We're not saying don't have plants, or we're not saying don't plant. We're not saying just start hacking code and that's how you will do. The other thing is also a lot of what people talk about is push-based planning or push scheduling. Right? There's a lot of literature where they talk about pull-based planning, where they build Empire State Building using a completely pull-based planning. You know, there are all these examples that we can learn from and look into, you know, what are the differences, how you can plan for a large project like an Empire State Building without having these huge grand plans beforehand. So there are answers that we have to go find out and find and look into in our context what applies, what makes sense in our context with the kind of people we have, with the constraints that we have in our system, what will make sense instead of blindly monkey seeing, monkey doing.
Feel free to catch us in the breaks, and we might not be able to cover everything that we want to. But for example, I have some examples that I could give to you from the perspective of how pull-based planning helped us, you know, to deliver better as opposed to a push-based plan. So we could discuss that over lunch or whatever. You know, the breaks.
I think it's also very context sensitive. In my current company, we don't do it, but in my previous company, we did it, and it was actually pretty valuable there.
And that's, I think, the message that we want to give as well, which is that it's all contextual. You have to think about your context. Don't blindly, you know, do stuff, right? You have to think about whether this is important to you or not, or what value it's giving to you.
Next point, iterations and time boxes. So what do you think, what are the motivations behind having iterations and time boxes? It's kind of building on the previous topic, but going more specific to the iteration aspect, the whole iterative aspect of things, and with time boxing.
Focus.
Come on, guys, you guys are doing this. Why are you
saying
this?
What is accomplished? What are things you've done over this span?
Some form of tracking.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Customer feedback.
Customer feedback. When you say customer, what does it mean?
You have a time box, so you basically get a customer feedback every time slot.
No, I want to dig a little more in terms of when you say customer, are you referring to the end user? Are you referring to the product owner or the product manager? Who is the customer in this case?
All the stakeholders,
everybody.
The product owner and the end user.
The product owner and the end users. Because that's something I've not seen a lot happen, where you involve end users at every sprint boundaries, at every, you know, time boxes.
It's maybe you a demo for the end user.
That depends on the product which you're working on.
That depends on the product, and you know, that's kind of what I want to get at is, you know, who is the customer? In some cases, that's not very clear.
Right.
You
will also get clear idea about what are items you need to release from this stuff.
That would fit at a much higher level, right? Here you're talking about iterating, the sprint boundaries, the time boxes. You're trying to say, okay, these are the set of things I want to work on, and I want to iterate over them, and I'll do that a few more times before I actually put something out there. Or maybe it's ready enough that I can put things out there. So it's more about the time box attitude, that I want to try and, you know, take this time box and work on these set of activities. So focus is one of the things I noticed that helps. It's about commitment, getting people to commit to certain things. So in that time box,
collaboration.
Sorry?
You tend to collaborate better, I mean, when you have iterations between teams.
You tend to collaborate better. That's not my experience, but I'll take that point.
A rhythm,
some kind of a rhythm, some kind of a, you know, cycles that you're going through.
It makes the work more streamlined. There is a continuous improvement in the iterations, and you evolve and become more streamlined towards the code.
More streamlining.
Yeah. At some point, I want to discuss the rhythm and the streamline as well. We'll get to it maybe later.
Yeah. So, Sandeep, do you want to share some of your experience in terms of...
I actually wanted to mention, because no one explicitly mentioned it in that way, but, you know, one of the main motivations behind iteration was to avoid thrashing, which is, you know, someone also pointed out that when I've started working on something, you know, if I have multiple stakeholders, they all have a different opinion of how maybe, you know, this should, or the direction that we need to take, and everyone will come and tell you that I think, you know, this is what we need to do, I think this is what we need to do. And what people start realizing is that, you know, this is not working out, it's not constructive. So what they did was they built a wall around them. They said, this is our iteration boundary. Within this, you can't tell us what to change. You tell us before that, and then, you know, we'll go into our rooms and we start coding, you know. And then after that, you'll get a boundary where you can change the plans again. But we need those gaps where, you know, you're not disturbing us at all. So that's primarily, and that's actually known as thrashing, where you know you can't get anything done because there are too many things happening to you, there are too many direction changes. So you're not moving in a forward direction, you're going all over the place. So that's one of the primary
context switching and thrashing. Because of that, the people are context switching and thrashing, and those are the problems that the time boxes were trying to address, right?
So one of the biggest issues that we've seen with iterations is that they tend to batch up work. What that means is that if you're doing five things and two of them are done, we'll still wait on the other three to finish to get that feedback, to do that customer demo, right? This also tends to get, it also tends to eventually get very waterfallish, where you're doing this, you know, in stages within those boundaries, which sort of doesn't help.
Yeah, in some sense, the if you see people bashing up waterfalls, the big reason they bash up waterfall is they say, you know, you do this one phase, you do this one phase, so it's basically batches. You're batching things and you're moving through them, through the analysis machine, through the design machine, through the coding machine, through the testing machine, and you're going through, you know, in this big batches, and when you, you know, you've done all the analysis, which means you've built up a whole inventory, which is not usable, right? Until you actually have something testable and usable by the user, everything else is building up inventory, which is a huge cost and risk for companies. So what the idea was, that let's break it down, let's come up, do it in iterations, let's break it down, let's take these thin slices, or what people refer to as the least marketable feature. Let's take these least marketable features and work through them. But what we fail to notice is, even in them, we're still, you know, batching things up, and maybe sometimes we're batching things that are unrelated because we want to fill the time box, right? We have three stories that only comes up to X story points or X estimate. We have some more time. What do? Let's take one other thing and fill this up. So that leads to what is referred to as the capacity utilization over focusing on the throughput, right? Instead of focusing on the throughput, now you're focusing on the capacity utilization. Nothing wrong with that. We're not saying that is wrong, but you know, that's kind of actually what we were trying to avoid in some sense, was to try and focus on throughput and not on capacity utilization. Makes sense?
So I've seen situations where you'll have an iteration for a month, and someone will finish something at the end of 5 days, and at the end of the month they're like, what did I do there? I don't remember what happened there. I'll have to revisit this again. That's probably because they bastard, you know. They had to go at the end of the sprint.
One other problem which I've seen with iterations is, like, when people from other methodologies move to Agile, they suddenly look at Agile as iteration as a smaller phase of waterfall, like multiple waterfalls, and that makes it extremely problematic.
So you do an analysis sprint, a design sprint.
Yeah.
That's also come. But we are not saying what is the, you know, you can take any methodology and screw it up. We are not going there. We are saying, you know, let's assume you're doing it well. But there's still issues with it. There's still things that you might want to think about that, you know, might not work well in your context. So we are, forget about people not doing it well. That's, let them have their cake and eat it too. Let's talk about people are doing it well, and we still think there's scope for improvement. We can still take it further, because we're all talking about, you know, continuous improvement and continuous taking our art of software development further. So we're trying to focus on that aspect. You know, these are the issues, even if you're doing it well. You're still batching up, you still have things that is going wrong, you still try and fix something which is focusing on capacity utilization, which might not necessarily be the goal that you were trying to solve. 15 minutes to go. My favorite topic.
Our favorite topic.
So what do you think is the rationale behind estimations, and what are the advantages of estimation?
Predictability.
Sorry?
Predictability.
That's interesting.
Transparency.
Wow. All controversial topics. Prioritization.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you got something which takes a long time, then you might reconsider whether you want to put it up or down, or where. Might be a low value item, takes a long time, put it down.
So building an engine for a car might take a long time.
Yeah.
Building a steering wheel might be a lot quicker. So would you build the steering wheel before you build the engine?
You might, like if you have the left wheel and the right wheel, but they're both the same value, but one takes a long time. I mean, this is you. Then you might want to do the other one first. You know.
I think both your metaphor and my metaphor kind of breaks down. It doesn't really work well in some way. So let's not go down that metaphor. But that's a point about, you know, helps you in prioritization. What are the points? How else does estimation help? What's the rationale behind estimation? Why did estimation come into
cost.
Picture?
To arrive at the cost.
To arrive at the cost. That's more of cost estimation. So when we talk about estimation itself, there are different forms of estimation. There's effort estimation, cost estimation, there's time estimation. Now you can map these together, plumb them, and put some fancy formula and come up with some cost. But you know, there are different types of estimation. Are there any other types of estimations?
Complexity
estimate and relative complexity estimate.
It's a big estimation tool for the customer as well, that by when he is going to get the product of the sprint or probably release.
That's time estimation.
Yes.
Right? Not necessarily complex. Complexity estimation will not tell you how, when we will deliver something.
Okay.
Right?
To help in improving the estimation on an iterative basis. So estimation is a good way to support the continuous improvement, which is the bottom line.
Estimations help you improve estimation, but what, or estimations
so
help
you
improve?
Without an estimate, you don't know whether you did something quite previously or not. So that kind of,
so you're
saying, metrics,
okay.
Support the continuous improvement. Right?
Just so I can reword that, if you said that like, it would take me 10 days and the estimate was 10 days, but it took you about 20 days. So now you can actually give
yeah,
a better commitment.
Yeah, the next iteration will help you to
set
the
benchmark.
What you said, I would want to continue on that. That complexity factor estimation ultimately boils down to time estimation, because that's what you are looking for, time estimation. Probably a complex problem is going to take a little longer or shorter. So ultimately it would boil down to the time.
Just to add to that, for example, if I realize that something is really complicated, and complexity has a context as well, right?
Yes.
Maybe writing a parser is complex for me who doesn't know anything about writing parsers, but if there's a team of compiler developers, they know how to write parser, right? They could do it in a day maybe, right? So complexity is also relative. So in that sense, what's complex? If I realize something was complex, I could maybe outsource it to someone who could do it maybe in a day for me.
Yeah.
So it might not necessarily translate into time in the sense that.
But
well,
estimation would help the coordination.
What I'm saying is that it doesn't directly translate into time.
But
not necessarily
no,
time.
What I'm saying is that it's boiling down to the time. It's not correspond to the time. That's
so it's one of the levers that you
not
could take. We could do this maybe offline. We could have this conversation.
Like coordination.
Project, what the future could be in terms of time and in terms of effort. You can see the big picture, make user pieces together.
By taking individual estimates of these pieces, you can build an overall plan.
Picture. Big picture, whole process.
It's a little far stretched for me, but we'll go with
it. There's an aspect that we haven't discussed, which is, am I estimating everything up front? Am I taking everything that I'm doing, am I estimating that up front to get that idea, or, you know? Do you get what I'm saying? At the iteration level.
It provides a platform where the team develops a better understanding of the requirements. You know, if I develop an estimation of one story point, somebody comes up with five, then probably there is a discussion about why he thinks it is five and why I think it is one. So there is a consensus which goes on, there is a discussion, and team develops a better understanding.
So if you want to decide, okay, you got a project, you want to go or not go, it may make a big difference. If it's like a 5-year project, you may not want to go. It's like a 1-year project.
So
you
talk about the feasibility. It helps
yeah.
you come up with the feasibility.
Right.
One thing what I observed, like estimation and perspective, like prioritization of the task, and second also it helps of distributing. Like I have 5-10 team members, like they have different kind of experience and expertise. Based on the estimation, let's say 20 hours, 30 hours, like that, based on the estimation, I can distribute the work to team members as well.
That actually is kind of quite contradicting to the whole self-organized team aspect, where people pick the task rather than being assigned, but let's say that works in your context and this helps you. Now I want to shift gears a little, because we have other topics to also cover, but with estimations, has anybody felt this predictability paradox issue? Yeah? what is predictability paradox? The idea is that, you know, I have some knowledge of this. If I have more knowledge about this, if I spend more time on this, I will come up with better estimates, right? Yeah. So how, when do you know it is good enough time to say, okay, I have enough knowledge to actually give an estimate? So that is a very slippery slope for a lot of people, including myself. Like, you try to, you know, spend more time. And a lot of times, after spending a lot of time, you still don't necessarily have a better estimate, because the higher you climb on the mountain, the better view you have of the things. But doesn't mean you know exactly how long it's going to take somewhere to get somewhere or things like that. So what predictability paradox is, just because you're spending more time, doesn't mean your estimates are going to be more accurate, which is an oxymoron.
How many people here think that because they've been estimating for a long time, they got better at it? They got better at estimating. Just because I've been doing it for a long time.
It's probably because they've treaded the same path and they know how much time it took.
Yeah, that's if someone raised their hand. I didn't see anyone raise their hand actually. Okay.
If the context is similar, if it's a similar one, then yes, it makes sense.
Would that be the case for everyone that raised their hand?
Similar stories, similar...
similar context.
There could be a more probability for getting the accurate estimation, but there is no guarantee. Because it depends upon many other factors, like on the person, and where are, many other things.
Using the word guarantee, when we're talking about probability, an estimation is itself maybe an oxymoron also. Because I can't guarantee.
It depends upon, there is no similar
There's someone there who
is considering estimation, right? Is it a project cost level or product cost level or sprint level? I think that also is a factor.
That's a factor as well, yeah. What level of estimation are you doing? Are you doing a feasibility study?
For a kickoff, precisely, we need to know how many resources you need, roughly, we have to trigger the project.
That kind of brings us to mythical man month in some case. If you realize that, you know, you can't finish, can you add more people on it and go faster? Experience is not always. How many people work in companies where estimation is mandatory? How many people work in companies where you don't have to really give an estimate?
Somebody else does it for us.
Somebody else does it. In that sense, it's still mandatory, and that's even worse.
That's even more scarier if someone has seen the estimate for me.
There are actually a lot of points we wanted to go in estimation itself, like the whole thing about lack of trust, buffering, student syndrome, filling in, you know, the work fills in the available time and stuff like that.
How many of you feel as if, you know, when someone's asking you for an estimate, it's almost as if they have a gun to your head and they're asking you for an estimate? How many of you feel it? That's the aspect of the lack of trust. You know, a lot of times people are asking for estimate because they don't trust people.
But then how do you break that? I mean, see, the thing is, I've been challenged by that. I mean, just let me step back a minute. When I say estimation, I go with God of, you know, it gives me an inference as to what it takes to do for different people at different times, in different inferences.
Just to clarify, we are not saying don't do it. Maybe in some context, it might be important.
Yeah, true.
Also,
but the thing is, the inferences you draw from estimation are different for different people, what I'm trying to get. See, the management would like to see an estimation from a certain perspective. For the team, like you said, it tells them as to what is in context available. If I put a certain number to it, what is it that I'm going to do, and things like that. But then, when I get into the religious aspect of doing this in an other sense or whatever period, you get caught up into this. And tomorrow, somebody else will actually, the management will put up a gun to you and tell you. So in that sense, I'm kind of stuck between saying that, you know, I have to please somebody tomorrow and not get caught up or shot by him, and try to put a gun to my people. So that trust factor or whatever, and if he's a far junior, how do I get out of that? You know, I mean, these are issues which are...
So is estimation helping you? Let's put it this way. Yeah.
No, it doesn't. I mean, on the floor, I mean, when you actually start cranking and working, it really probably bashed up in day one itself. But the fact of the matter is, everybody wants to know this number, and then only you can get to start.
I've worked for a lot of consulting companies, like services company, right? And this is typical. When they outsource, they want to push the risk on you. They want you to give an estimate, and they want to say how long it's going to take, how much it's going to cost, and 5 minutes to go. That's an estimate. He's putting a gun down. That's actual. And you know, a lot of times you try and you do your best and you still end up overworking, burning yourself out, or you end up compromising on quality. Everyone knows of the golden triangle, right? The project manager's golden triangle.
Yeah.
You know, everyone wants more scope, less time, and less, no, more scope, less time, and less effort.
Is that a way of saying the time's up?
That's one way of, I don't know, I'm even questioning if it will help the guy who's asking for estimates.
So
there have been a lot of cases where I have gone up to the CIO of the company and I asked, you know, you're asking for these estimates, tell me in the last 25 years of your career, when people have given you estimate, how confident were you about the estimate, how did it make you feel, what was your goal with the asking the estimate, what were you, you know, you talk about, you know, I can plan the other activities and things like that, did you, how much buffering do you do on that? So this, you know, if you sit down and have that conversation with the guy asking you for the estimate, it boils down to, you know, a few of these things about, you know, educating them about, you know, the predictability paradox thing about, you know, if I can deliver value at a constant stream to you, that is a good sense for you to actually start seeing when probably things might be completed, rather than getting caught up upfront when you have least knowledge about the project, right? When you're starting something, that's when you have the least knowledge about it. And you're trying to give an estimate at that point in time, which is quite risky, right? So instead trying to go through some process and then seeing how you're going along by focusing on value rather than focusing on the how much hours and things like that seems to work better in my context.
Here again, I have an example. If you could catch me over lunch, we could discuss that as well, of a situation where we had the same problem and we switched mode, you know, to showing value. We had sales guys who wanted an estimate to give to customers. We had, you know, management who wanted an estimate. But we switched over to showing them value and now we don't do any estimates at all.
Typically,
so we could discuss
estimates
that.
Are always associated with some risks as well. And also leave an open disclaimer that, yeah, this is prone to be defined or, you know, subject to adaptation.
I just have a very bad taste with estimation because I've been in a situation where we spend way too much time on estimation, way too much time on doing that, and when it boils down to actually getting stuff done, you know, none of that really helps you and it starts getting in your way.
Yeah, obviously this is contextual also. There might be situations where you have to do it, where it might help as well. But in our experience, the stuff that, you know, we've been working on, in most cases it was of no use to us.
But how do you define, just one question, how do you define
3 minutes to go, 10 slides more,
yeah,
you know,
estimation.
Did you mention everything in the estimation?
We need to jump ahead. We can talk more about that, but our idea is not to cover everything, it's to spark these thoughts where people are thinking about these things. That's our goal. Sustainable pace. What is sustainable pace?
Not burning out.
Sorry?
Not burning out.
Not burning out. That's the rationale behind why you want to have sustainable pace. But how do you define sustainable pace? If you look at extreme programming, the first version of extreme programming talked about 40-hour work week. 40-hour work week is sustainable pace. If you do more than 40 hours, the chances are you're burning out. How many people believe in that?
You mean in the number or that you shouldn't do it?
The number for now, and then we'll talk about doing too much.
What does that 40 hours mean to you guys? Does that mean that you're consistently delivering in those 40 hours?
I wouldn't say 40 hours, probably. In fact, my productivity is much lesser than that. So, but the thing is, if you're working too much, probably you're not being true to your team, or later someone else joins the team, they're expected to work that much as well. I mean, it's just not sustainable for anybody to continue delivering the same amount of work. Probably the customer expects more work out of you just because you burned out on one metric.
So those are all the drawbacks of, you know, and those could not be problem with sustainable pace, but those could be problem because of other things, right? That the customer, you set that expectation with the customer and things like that, is not necessarily a problem of sustainable pace or working extra. We're not suggesting work extra, right? We're trying to understand what is the motivation behind sustainable pace.
More focus.
If you're leaning towards getting burnt out, then your focus starts reducing. You start doing stupid mistakes and things like that. But how do you know when to draw that line, and is that consistent? Like in my experience, I am productive at certain time of the day. I'm not productive at certain time of the day. It might still mean I'm only working 6 hours a day. you know, that the focus thing is not something to do with how much you're working, but it's more to do with what times of day suit better for you in terms of working. There are weeks when I'm not productive, there are weeks when I'm uber productive, right?
So yeah, I could have a 2-hour session where I'm very productive and I could burn out or feel very tired, as opposed to, you know, working for 8 hours and doing nothing except for playing solitaire maybe.
And there are also cases
where
you can like work for 12 hours and still feel not burnt out. When you're like really in the flow.
A lot of times, you know, and that's where we want to get at, is the flow seems to be more important. There are times when you're not in the flow and you could still be doing 6 hours or 8 hours and still feel burnt out. You might not be enjoying what you're doing and you might feel burnt out after 4 hours of doing it. And you might be in cases where you really enjoy, you're in the flow, you're in the groove of doing things, and you can work easily for 16 hours. I mean, how many people have spent 16 hours at work and felt productive? All of us, most of us,
yeah.
Right? Then
one
what is
or 2 days?
Okay. For 2 days.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anybody more than 2 days? I just lost out my pair partner. We paired for like more than 6 months at about a very large 72-hour work weeks. And you can ask him if he felt burnt out. It's very subjective, again, what we're getting at. One other example I want to draw is, how many people studied throughout the year for your exams?
No one.
How many people studied the last day of the exam, the previous day of the exam?
There you go.
What happened to sustainable pace?
That's for one day, not for the whole semester.
Exams are for 16 years you've done that. And exams are for at least a week or more. So we're the whole challenging that it's not 2 days, it's probably more than that. We've done that in a lot of times. We need to move on. Daily scrums and stand-up meetings. A lot of people mentioned that you know, they think that's indispensable. How many people do stand-up meetings every day?
How many people are forced to do it every day? How many people love doing stand-ups every day? They look forward to it.
What is the value you derive from stand-up meetings? You need to speak up.
Yeah. We discussed what is the task the developers are going to do today. And we also involve QA in that discussion. So then QA also means we check with QA and what is going on, what entered into diligence, how are they being like fixed or is they can reopen. So those kind of discussion also help, because see, we are a small company, so we have a lot of issues in QA. During that discussion also we found that some duplication of issues also we can.
So you're saying it helps with communication basically?
Communication.
Yes. So there's a very dynamic information pool for the project.
Dynamic information.
It's
what
sharing,
else for people
sharing,
who mentioned?
Sharing across the team. What is
sharing across the team.
What about team bonding? No one mentioned that.
That's very important. Team bonding.
We didn't have static for 2 days and three people ended up implementing the same feature.
You did a stand-up and you still...
We did do a stand-up for 2 days.
You did not do a stand-up.
And three of us ended up doing the same thing.
So were you guys, you know, distributed across locations?
Yeah.
Distributed across locations.
Yeah.
Hmm.
I kind of mandate stand-ups. The reason only being that to break the jinx of, you know, from the traditional to this, and to ingrain the philosophy of why you need to do this so that the positive confrontation gets along. So, I mean, as opposed to you are used to working in silos or in cubicle kind of a mode, that's one mode where you break out of it and try to do as a team and get the spirit going. So, I mean, not in the initial sense, but if you are mature enough in a couple of sprints and things like that, I would not pay much attention to it, so long as the flow is maintained.
So, a couple of quick issues that we see with stand-ups. One is again the trust factor. You know, a lot of people raise their hands that they are forced to do stand-ups. That again is a sign that there's no trust within the team as well. And the stand-ups is a way for them to, I don't know, it's not a way for them to solve the problem as well. They're just making it worse by doing it.
In some places, it's also a symptom of micromanagement. Right. You know, you see Scrum Masters, or you see people, you know, asking how many hours left, how many hours left, how many hours left, and that's kind of their version of stand-up meeting. Or deriving data from it so they can then, you know, what used to happen once in a month earlier, now they can do it on the harassment they can do every day.
The biggest problem that I've noticed is that someone mentioned communication there, right? The whole idea is that you should communicate more. I think if you are communicating regularly, the stand-up then just becomes a formality. You know, it's just a formal thing that you have to go and stand and talk to each other.
If you have a team
and
of
that
people,
doesn't build a team, right? That just builds, I don't know what
frustration.
Yeah, just frustration.
I think I think when the transition happens from the traditional system and they're trying to adapt towards agile, initially there will be resistance, but usually if you do the sprint planning transitions from one sprint to other sprint, you make sure you give the team the perspective that this is where we got the value add, we stand up. Make sure there's a value add, and then retrade that on every sprint. Then that kind of remove that jig that, okay, end up with something. That helped a lot.
Okay.
So,
initially there was this thing thread over there, because I can go down that path and say, you know, because we went through waterfall, because we went through this, because we went through this, now when you have new persons coming on team, do they also have to go through the same learning process to appreciate the value, or they can start with something that we believe today? You know, that's again something to ask ourselves, because a lot of times we say, you know, they have to do this, they have to do this, they have to do this because they can understand the value behind it. But not necessary, because not all of us have done every single programming language to understand, appreciate programming languages that we use today. There was a gentleman over there.
Yeah, again, what you said, like, the stand-up meetings, just keep communicating segments all the time. But that's again an ideal situation, right? For example, we three form a team. If I keep talking to you, I keep talking to him, you cannot solve the problem. But sometimes there would be a requirement we three should get together, understand how are we bearing on the dependencies and
sure, so do just-in-time stand-up meeting.
Or you just walk up to me.
No, it doesn't matter. Stand-up meeting can happen at coffee, or it has to happen. But again, what we are doing here is a formalized one. But you don't need to really...
Yeah, that's the problem, right? And the word that it has to happen. You know, when you don't have anything to share, what's the point of the stand-up?
You don't need to do it in a room. You just go to... Every day, do it on someone's office. Put it in your office, tomorrow in your office. But again, there has to be some forum where we need to be in sync on how are we faring on our government.
The other point people talk about is knowing who is where. I think if you know, there are alternatives to that. You know, there are pretty much very powerful alternatives. If you have like a story wall, then you have a sense of who's working on what. And you focus on making sure people are in sync with respect to the story wall. You don't necessarily need the stand-up meeting to know who's working on what. But we're not saying that discard your stand-up meetings. We are again saying that think about, you know, what is the reason behind stand-up meetings. We've done away with stand-up meetings. We don't do stand-up meetings anymore. And it just seems to work fine.
Yeah, this other thing I wanted to mention quickly is that, you know, people talk about continuous improvement, right? How do you do it continuously? What does it mean to do it continuously? And people usually translate that in terms of, you know, by making it a habit. That's how you'll end up doing it continuously, right? So you make it a ritual basically. Though what happens when you do that is when you create a habit, your mind starts switching off when you're doing that stuff, right? It happens with everything. So which is the thing that I have noticed when you're doing stand-up, people then just switch off at that time. So it's just a formality that they have to do.
Proper training or guidance also helps, because when people see how things are done in the right way, then they begin to adopt that. If they don't know how it is done, they just read something, they say, okay, yesterday I did this, today I did this. Probably
I think
this
part of what we're saying is that it's up to the team to discover the right way.
Yeah, the rules
of someone from outside can't maybe discover
it. Yeah, somebody who's just doing training for their whole life can't come and teach you how to do stand-ups correctly.
So,
it just doesn't work that way.
What happens is, I'll give you an example
where,
what happens is over time teams evolve, projects evolve as well. So what was right for us maybe 6 months ago is not right for us now also. So you're constantly, you know, discovering what you need to do as opposed to following, you know, one set of a process rather.
But
before we break is the favorite topic of clean code. TDD, refactoring, simple design, whatever you have. How many people...
Just one sec, we are eating into your lunch time. Time, so yeah. If you guys want to leave, you can do that as well. It's up to you guys, yeah? We won't mind if you get up and leave.
So, how many people think clean code is absolutely... Interesting.
How many of you all have clean code?
Put your hand down. We worked in that code.
So who else? I didn't see the hands. Who has clean code?
How many people think they have clean code? Half hand up.
What's
clean code? S-driven, you could do constant, you do continuous refactoring all the time, you practice simple design. If anybody walks into your team, the whole notion is you only have the whole principle of what you need, the simplest possible thing that could work, keep it simple and stupid, all of that philosophy.
So it works, and it is not clean. Is it not?
Sorry?
The code works, but it is not clean, it is probably lacking in refactoring, half and up. So, if it works, what is wrong with it?
That's the question we are asking.
If I do it, I would believe that it is very clean code. But somebody looks at it and then tells me it is not clean anymore.
So it's subjective.
Yeah.
Code is not clean.
It's when you talk about the practices.
It's not just about the working file and functionality in terms of functionality. It should be, maintainable. We are talking about
in Agile, a lot of people talk about clean code. I'm cutting you short because I need to run. A lot of people talk about clean code is very important, TDD, refactoring, these things are absolutely important. We are by no way saying they're not important. What we're trying to highlight is trying to understand for yourself where to draw those lines, where you say I've done enough of refactoring, where I've done enough of this. Because the reality is, if you look around, in the code bases you work, where people maintain code bases and stuff like that, how many of it is clean code? And very rarely people will raise their hand saying, yes, it is clean code. And then you ask them, even if you've done TDD, you've done all of this, why is it not clean code?
How many of you think there's a very strong correlation between clean code and successful products?
Sustenance of a product. I'll add one more word. Sustenance of a product, clean code is required.
Sustenance of a product.
See, obviously, the clean code is trying to have a clean code.
I'm sorry?
We always try to have a clean code.
So I think that
as we have a complete coverage of testing also. Testing will never be 100%. So clean code, again, we set some guidelines for ourselves. That may not be a complete guideline from your perspective.
Right, I think that's part of what we're saying. What we're saying is that if you all know the classic benefit curve, when you start doing this, you get a lot of benefit, but after that, it'll slow down and it'll get incrementally much. The benefit that you derive out of it will start decreasing over time also. The problem is that we developers sometimes don't know when to stop also. Right? People just refactor. I've seen people spend a couple of months refactoring also.
No need to obsess with the clean code, but it depends upon the context and business value and what is the kind of product you are developing.
Another point that we want to make, which is that there are times when clean code is important, there are times when they are not. If you're starting off a product, maybe you don't need all this stuff, right? You just want to try out an idea, get it out to the customer, validate it, see if it works, right?
At that point, discovery is more important than sustainability, because you don't even know if this product anybody is going to use or not. Once you discover what the customer probably needs or have some sense of it, maybe you could then rewrite it from scratch, maybe refactor this, then you have to weigh your options and figure out what is the best way. And sometimes, starting with clean code because you're doing something extremely critical is important. And it's very context sensitive. You have to see what is applicable in your context rather than saying, you always have to do this and this is indispensable practice. Because there are a lot of startup companies that we come across or we're meeting these days where they don't do test-driven development, where they do some refactoring, and they're still able to build the product, get it out there, and they it's not like they're struggling to do anything because they don't have clean code.
Just one second.
Many a time of failure is by the customer requirement. Many a time it is driven by the customer requirement. The customer says, I want a result. I want 80% zero test cases to run.
Right, we can talk about ways to do that without having clean code also.
Requirements is...
Simple design itself is a very relevant term and it is very difficult to define what is simple. So I believe something like performance testing and user acceptance testing can be mapped to how clean your code should be.
Usability has nothing to do with how clean your code is, right?
And what I'm saying is that it's very difficult to define what exactly is clean. Like if I'm like 4 years of experience, probably I write clean code, which appears clean to me, and there comes a person with 7 years of experience and he tells me what the SHIT you have written. So it is very difficult to define what exactly clean is. So as far as my acceptance criteria, user APIs are working, and there is no substantial damage to the performance of the product, probably I would say it is clean.
Right. Someone has to define those acceptance criteria.
Yeah.
So I have a friend who has this, it's a Hindi dialogue where he says, "Usme fayda to hai, lekin wo fayde ka fayda kya hai?" Which means, there is benefit. What is the benefit of that benefit also? A lot of times we think about the benefit, but we never think about the benefit of that benefit, This is giving us this, but what use is that to us right now in this context also? You had one last point.
Yeah. When you say a successful product, what did you mean by a successful product? A product that never breaks and works on all occasions and
makes money.
Degrades gracefully, or makes something that is embraced by people.
That's a very dear customer. Both?
It's a very
product owner.
Product owner.
Product sponsor.
Requirements is like a programmer's delight.
Programmer's delight. I would agree to that.
Not if it keeps changing though.
Yeah. That's why one requirement.
Fixed requirements. I'm trying to cut this short, so in my world, requirements is one of those four letter words. To me, what do you mean by to be satisfied? It's very vague. A lot of times requirements means that this is mandatory. Right, the sense of this is mandatory, and in software there is no such thing called this is mandatory. A lot of times people don't know what they want until they actually see it. Until they start using it, that's when they realize. Also, Fred Brooks talks about, you don't know what the real problem is until you've solved the problem. So how can you define requirements? In some cases maybe you can, but in a lot of cases, in my experience, I've never been on a project where we had the perfect requirements, where we knew exactly what the requirement was. Requirement is also a solution domain thing. It fits into the solution domain. And a lot of times we forget to think about the problem domain. What is the problem that we are trying to solve? Yes, you need this screen, you need this screen, you need to do this, you need to do that. But what is the problem that you are trying to solve? Do you even need the software? How many people ask that question? Right? A lot of times, I've worked with NGOs, and there are other people who will jump on and they'll say, oh, we'll build this website, we'll do this thing, there'll be this backend stuff. And you look at it and you say, you know what? All you need is pre-printed letters, you can send them. That's all you need. There is no software required. So what is requirement in this context? Is requirement about the goal that the user has, the problem that they're trying to solve? Or is it about this implementation of that problem, a solution, or implementation of the solution that you're thinking? So it's very subjective, and a lot of times we get caught up in, we need the perfect requirements. Let's spend time getting the requirements. And a lot of times I've seen projects go down the rabbit holes trying to get the requirements.
Yeah, but in the context of product companies, requirements becomes extremely important, where we define what the product needs to do. Because that comes from the users, that comes from whoever. But at the end of it, when it is crystallized, you know exactly what the product is supposed to do. Not like what the user wants and all that.
My experience is,
I work for a products company, and I think the most important thing for us is feedback from the customers. We also try to discover what the customer wants, right? We can say, inside a room, inside the company, we only have opinions, we don't have facts.
Yeah.
We get the facts only when we go out there and show it to the customer.
Exactly. I mean, in our context, for example, when we want to build a car, it actually comes from the users. Like, we build a concept and all these things, but when we get it as requirements, so they have to be done to satisfy what we found out that the customer wants.
So like for instance, some acceptance criteria are there to even to release a product into market, like for instance specifications in some standard bodies in case of some mobile.
So is acceptance criteria requirements?
One of them could be, which is mandatory, you have no escape room there.
Yeah.
To say that there is no need for it.
Actually, I don't get the
very much subjective.
Whether too detailed requirements are bad, requirements are bad.
The whole notion of requirements. What is requirement?
I think it's primarily about the word requirements. It puts you in a mindset where you think that you know it's absolutely necessary, and you don't therefore tend to ask questions about do we need to do this or not.
It's right? Not my problem. Somebody else has figured this out. I just need to build this thing. Right? That's the problem. Somebody else has figured out what the requirement is.
I've been in way too many situations where someone's got a requirement and it feels wrong, but they're still trying to make it work. Right? And they're not thinking about whether I need to do it or not, but they're caught up in trying to make it work. And you know, I've seen so much effort getting wasted because of that.
Probably
right.
I guess don't be a dumbass when listening to the customer requirements. You need to take the requirements.
Right, requirements come from everywhere, right? It could come from your CEO, it could come from your
manager,
it could come from anywhere. But the fact that you use the word requirement itself sort of puts you in a mindset, which is what you want to change.
It's a mindset that this is there, it's given, we have to do this, there is no questioning, it's kind of building this wall, they built the requirement, they tossed it over, let's build this. Now that's not what Agile is about, it's about discovering what the end users need, what the businesses need, and putting both of them into perspective and trying to understand how can we do less software? Now, if you guys have read Agile Manifesto, one of the Agile Manifesto principles is simplicity. What does simplicity mean? And they define simplicity as the art of maximizing work not done. And the moment you put requirements into the picture, that's challenging the whole simplicity notion. It's about doing as much as possible, as quickly as possible, and Agile boils down to rapid software development. Not necessarily simplicity. That's what we're challenging here.
Yeah. I'm just reminding you guys again that we've eaten into 30 minutes of your lunch break.
I think we should just close. Retrospective is another thing that we find is a ceremony and doesn't add much value. I'm not going to spend much time, we're going to move on.
There are places where it's important, but in most cases where it just becomes a ceremony as well. How do we get feedback?
Retrospectives is maybe one way of getting feedback, but are you going to wait, batch up things and get feedback? A lot of times you want to get feedback on a continuous basis. You know, if something goes wrong, sit down, ask 5 whys. Maybe that's a technique. You don't have to wait till the end of the sprint or iteration. You know, there are a lot of times when, you know, you can sense it, you can start adapting, inspecting and adapting instead of waiting till the end of things. So there's a lot of notion that you start building ceremony around how to do retrospective. And I've been in some of the sessions where the Uber retrospective facilitators are there and the whole thing goes for a mess, right? So, you know, you talk about all this stuff and how much is it really helping you doing these retrospectives, is it helping you or just sitting down with people and having a, you know, appreciative inquiry kind of a discussion or some other kind of discussion is helping you. There's so many options. So let's not lock us down saying retrospective is the only way to get feedback of our process and inspect.
It's a collation point, right? Where you gather inputs all the during runtime.
Very interesting. I was interested in asking that question. How many people have been in retrospectives have taken down action points that never got done? Or they've never got touched as well. Right? So that's one of the points that I wanted to highlight.
No, I'm just saying that you are not holding the retrospective meeting per se collect, but you might be collecting what you have already done. So it depends on how the Scrum Master is actually driving it.
Scrum Master.
It's where is the Scrum Master has to drive it.
Right.
Alright. Quality assurance.
I'm going to stop there. We can have that discussion later, actually.
Scrum Master,
Scrum
driving.
Masters are my favorite topics.
Right. That would have been our last thing. But quality assurance. I think a lot of people have by now read about this, it's building quality into the process rather than having the last thing as the process and slapping it on. So I just had a quick story that I wanted to complete, and if you guys are getting late, please do leave. Alright? The story comes from how looms used to work. So back in those days when you know you had looms, you had a lot of defects being produced by the loom. So what they would do is at the end of the day, they would put two people who would sit next in front of each other, and they would start checking each cloth. The moment the thread is missing, they detect, they take this cloth and they say, this is waste. You know, if there's some insect woven into the cloth, oh, new design, that's a waste, you put it out. So people try to sit at the end of the day and try to find out, and then they saw there's a lot of wastage being produced, which, you know, could have been probably stopped beforehand. You know, now you have too much wastage, so it's too high cost. So what they started doing was they started putting one person on the loom. What does this map do? You know, the traditional waterfall kind of a mentality where at end of some phase, you sit down and you check things and then you raise them defects and things like that. That's wastage that you've detected. Now people in agile world try to optimize that by saying, let's put the QA people on the teams. Let them be embedded in the teams. And what happened in the loom phase is they had one person each loom, but they're still so subjective because it depends on the skills of this person. If the person has to go somewhere, then will the person leave the loom running at the risk of something slipping through or stop the and take a productivity hit on the looms? Things like that started creeping in. Also, in spite of doing that, they still had to do at the end of the day some amount of checking to make sure things are not slipping out. So if you map that to your teams today, you know, you might have QAs on your team, but you still need to do some kind of a regression testing before a release and stuff like that. You still need to do some other kinds of tests before the release. So that kind of maps to this. And that's when Toyota, which is the precursor to Toyota as a company, kicked in and they started manufacturing looms. They said one of the biggest problems we find is missing breaking threads. And how can we fix that problem? So what they started doing is they started putting these small levers on top of each thread. And as soon as a thread broke, it would go jam the machine. And that way, you know, broken threads didn't slip through. And they started building quality into the process. They went on to innovate by, you know, basically having automatic thread replenishment. They had parallel threads so that if one broke, it would not take any time. And they actually went on to innovate by building quality into the process rather than relying on after the fact check of something going wrong. Now you take that and you draw parallels to what happens in software, and it's interesting to see that, you know, there's so many lessons we can learn in terms of how we think about quality assurance. You know, somebody coming in later and assuring you that the quality of the product is going to be good.
I try to introduce something into the system in our team by saying that we'll ring a bell as soon as we find a bug, and everybody will stop working. That's what they used to do.
That's right. That's the Toyota stop the production line culture.
So do you think, I got a very strict response to that, obviously. Do you think the customer is going to allow us to sit down and wait for something to be fixed which was not their fault but the team's fault? Why should the customer waste their time and money waiting for some quality model to take place and, you know, and make things better? So how, if it is good as you probably are going to suggest, how do we actually incorporate this, making the production stop? How do we get the customers?
So there are lots of
I think you know, that's one way to do it, making your production stop. I think it's more about building it into the process where you're doing things, you know, that stop it from repeating again.
So
not necessarily telling everyone to stop programming now.
CI, continuous integration, is one of the manifestation of that thought process of stop the production line. If somebody checks in, the build breaks, then you stop, and whoever checked in has to fix it before they proceed. So that's kind of the manifestation of stop the production line culture.
In a distributed environment, the guy who checked in, it's a lot of code, it takes a lot of time, his kid is waiting, his kid is probably not well, his wife is falling, and he goes off. Right, and the build breaks after half an hour. The on-site team is sitting now. They can't do anything because according to the team's rule, it says the guy who broke it must fix it, but the guy who broke it is not there. So,
a lot of things we can.
For example, why does the build take half an hour? Maybe that's maybe the first question that you might tackle. So there are a couple of things there that we can discuss maybe after.
Okay.
Alright, we want to end this and we want to let you guys think about now in this context, just take a minute and think for yourself, what are the practices you think you can throw out of your project? Just think to yourself, I don't expect you to give an answer, this is a thought we want you guys to leave with in terms of thinking about what are the practices you can throw out of your team and still be as productive as you guys are, or as happy as you guys are, or whatever your measure of success is.
maybe throwout seems like a very drastic word. You want to think about it in terms of what are the practices that are getting in the way, what are the practices that I'm not happy about, you know, what are the practices that I don't think are providing any value at all.
Readiness to throw.
So this is the real thank you slide, guys, by the way. No monkeys were harmed in the making of this presentation. And this presentation was made using only recyclable fixets.
What is asking feedback for this slide that you are not going to use
at all? We used it, you missed out. That's it, guys.
Alright.
Lunch.
Time to go have lunch and then we'll be back here for programming with the stars at 2 o'clock. Not much time.